Jesus, there's nothing impossible.
Christ arise. Everybody. You're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, this is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. Now I'm alive. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Whoa.
search for you today, Lord. Lord, we thank you again for who you are and what you've done in our lives. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Y'all can be seated.
How are you guys doing today? Man, it is great to see you. I want to welcome you here. My name's Josh. I'm one of the pastors at The Rock, and I'm thankful you're joining us. All right, whether you're joining us online, maybe you're at Coastal, maybe you're in Aynor, maybe you're in Conway at the Box or at the coffee bar, wherever you're tuning in from, wherever you're sitting, thank you for being here. And let me just say this. I don't want you just to be here. We don't want you just to be here. We want you to connect with us. So if you're online, make sure you stop by the Digital Connect Corner and connect with us. If you're on one of our campuses, go to the Connect Corner there, because we would love to get you teamed up. We'd love to see you serving on a ministry and joining on mission with us. Maybe you come all the time and you just haven't taken that step. Well, today would be a great day to do that. Maybe you're brand new. Well, today would be a great day as well, because we believe when you jump on mission that you'll see God do things in you and through you that you never imagined possible. All right. So again, thanks for being with us, and let's make sure we connect. Now, before we dive into the message, let me just share a couple things that are coming up. One, summer is right around the corner, which means we've got camp coming. We've got camp for elementary kids. We've got camp for rising middle schoolers. We got camp for rising high schoolers. So if you're of that one of those age groups, or you're a parent of somebody in that age group, make sure you get signed up for camp. You can do so on the app. And then the other thing I want you to know that is coming is our next series. See, next weekend we're starting a new series, and we're calling it The Pack. All right, and when we say The Pack, we mean like a pack, like a pack of wolves. And oftentimes in church, we think of wolves as bad, but what we're actually gonna be encouraging you to do next week is to let the wolf rise up inside of you. And I know that might sound really weird, and I'd like to dive all into it, but I'd spoil it. So instead, I'll just simply say, make sure you come back next week as we talk about what it means to think like a wolf. All right, well, that's about it for the future stuff. It's time to dive into today. Today, we're gonna wrap up our series on Faith Is. And we've talked about how faith is audacious, and faith is sacrificial, and faith is evident, and faith is a lot of other things. I won't go all into them. Today, we're gonna wrap up the series, and we're gonna talk about faith is enduring. It's gonna be awesome. I'm glad you're here. Let's go ahead and dive into Faith Is Enduring.
What's happening, Rock Church? Good to see y'all here. 11:30 service. I'm glad to hear it. My name is Scott, and I'm one of the pastors here, and I have the blessed opportunity to share in this message today and help us kind of bring into conclusion this sermon series. But before we get started here, I want to welcome especially those at our Aynor campus right now are watching and connecting with us. So let's make them feel welcome as we are walking through this together. Typically, on any given Sunday, you'd find me in Aynor, but today, Michael Bensville is going to be taking the back half of the sermon today, and so I'm excited for that opportunity and just having him an opportunity to share faith and to share his walk with the people in Aynor. But also people who join us online. Every week, we have people who log in from around the world, around the country, who actually walk with us, and that's a really cool thing. So if you're watching online, we just want you to know you matter to us, and make sure if you got any questions, make sure you connect to the hosts that are right here in the chat box. And especially if you're on YouTube, you know, you can minimize the screen and get into the chat, especially if you're watching from a device. So we're going to be jumping into the last part of this series called Faith Is. We're talking about faith being enduring. But before we do that, I want to pause for a second. And just, it's a weekend, it was a long weekend. A lot of people even, you know, started Thursday night, they took Friday off so they had Monday off, and really stretching out the weekend. And I applaud that strategy. It's a good strategy. It's a great weekend to do that. It's Memorial Day weekend. And I want to stop for a second and just simply say thank you. Thank you for all the men and women who have given the full extent of their service. And Memorial Day, that is what we celebrate. It's different than Veterans Day. It's different than Armed Services Day. Memorial Day is a time when we pay tribute to the memory of people who have gone before. But not only saluting those men and women, but especially the families who are still walking that out. To know that the families who are walking that out and for paying that price we thank you, and we recognize today, we wanted to start before the sermon, pause and say thank you, especially to the families that are walking that out. I have the privilege of standing here, freely assembled together, speaking freely and openly without fear of retribution as an American citizen because of that that sacrifice, and I do not take that lightly, and I just want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart and on behalf of our church, okay? Secondly, it's a great weekend because it is typically the end of May is kind of the beginning. June's right behind, and June is wedding season, right? So in my house, that's nothing different. We celebrated an anniversary yesterday, 17 years, and Amanda has still put up with me. And give her all the credit. Yeah, give her all the credit. But that's just a PSA. Guys, that the chances are high. Some of you guys have an anniversary coming up this month. I'm just giving you a running start, okay? So ladies, you can thank me for that later if you actually have an anniversary this month. So want to celebrate that. We're talking about weekends, and we were talking about this particular weekend. And Josh said, hey, Scott, I think you should preach that sermon on endurance, especially that weekend because of my personal preferences. And basically what he was saying is I'm a particular kind of stupid. And I have a very kind of a stupid way of looking at life is I love pain. And here's what I mean. My perfect weekend, like a really long weekend, is I get dropped off in the middle of a swamp somewhere or maybe a mountain pass or just somewhere in the nowhere and says, you have the weekend to figure it out. Don't die. Now, I do that a lot. In my house, we hear this a lot. My wife said, what are you doing this weekend? And I'll tell her, and she'll say, please don't die. And then she knows that I take people with me to do these adventures. And then she'll say, please bring them home in one piece. Yes, ma'am, I will. And then she'll say, you know, you're going to run out of friends one day, right? Like, you make your friends do all these crazy things. And I do because I have a ministry that actually uses adversity to help men become better versions of themselves. So adversity is a great thing if we know how to let it run its course. We do this on a daily basis. I work out with a group of guys. We do this in the parking lots all over our area because we believe that getting together and taking that daily red pill of adversity makes us better if we bring adversity into our life and helps us mature and become more complete in who God's calling us to be. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. I'm excited about talking about endurance, which is what we're going to wrap up the faith series with. Faith is enduring. And we're going to talk about how to endure life and how to endure pain and how you, by this sermon today and by the scriptures we read together, you can be better at enduring whatever life throws your way. And I'm going to show you some way and equip you with some ways from scripture is going to equip us with some ways that we can grow our endurance. We can become more emotionally resilient, more spiritually resilient, and even physically resilient to whatever life brings our way. And what's beautiful is scripture lays it out. Just really plain, really clear, and we're going to walk through two verses of scripture, and you're going to leave here today with five things to grow your endurance. Now, let me pause and say, these are not five easy steps, okay? There are, I don't know who lied to y'all and told you there's three easy steps to being a Christian or five easy steps. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Like, there are five things we can do that are easy to say, hard to do. Are you with me on that? We're going to talk about five ways we can grow our endurance, our resilience. They're not easy, but they work. Because here's the thing. The call to the Christian life is never a call to easy. Life will not get easier. I hate to knock the truth lens off for just a minute. For life doesn't get easier. You can get better. People of faith, to be a disciple of Christ doesn't mean that we pick up our cross that life will get easier, but through the power of the Holy Spirit and the help of God and His truth in our life, we can get better. So life may not get easier, but we can get better at dealing with it. And that's exactly what Hebrews chapter 12 is calling us to do. Having said we've been 7 weeks talking about what faith is, and we've been reading about people who've endured a lot of things. And so now we're going to kind of talk about endurance, and I want to define it before we get started. Can I do that? Make sure we're all on the same page. What do I mean by endurance? It's simply this. It is your ability to remain patient in the presence of pain. Sit with that definition for just a moment, because the reason I'm using the word patient When you read scripture and you read the word that is translated as endurance, you easily could also translate that word as patience. To have a patience, to sit with something, to not run away from it, to like let it do its work. So endurance is this, our ability to remain patient in the presence of pain. That's what endurance is, because life's going to hurt, things are going to happen, but for us to remain patient and to have a resilience that we don't back away, we lean into it because God's going to use it for His good and His glory, right? Now, I want to read through two verses of Scripture because I believe just reading Scripture aloud in the public arena is one of the best things we can do as a country, all right? I just believe that in my heart of hearts. It's something we don't do enough of, and I just want to read Scripture, and then we're just going to walk right back through it, okay? So if we're going to read this. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 says this, "Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with an endurance the race God has set before us." Now, verse 2 is the how. The how is this. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. And now he's seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Now, I want to explain kind of holistically what's happening in this scripture. If you're reading in Hebrews chapter 12, you would have gotten here through Hebrews chapter 11, which is everything we've said for the last 7 weeks. Hey, do you remember the story of Abraham? You remember the story of Noah and Joshua and Enoch and Abel and all of these people? And then there's people kind of at the end of it, like it got really, really hard, but they all endured it as an example for our faith. Now, the writer of Hebrews, we don't know who that was, but they were incredibly intelligent, an incredible writer with the Greek that they used, the wordplay that they used, the structure. But the power of the Holy Spirit and how God instructed them to write this is a beautiful thing, because here's what's happening. They're saying to the Hebrew audience, you remember all these people as a Hebrew people, as our collective memory as a nation. And they would have said, yes, I know Enoch, I know Jacob, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all these people. I remember that. But he's also writing in context, because scripture is always happening in a context. And the context for this audience were people who were Jewish, but they lived in the Greco-Roman world. They lived in the Greek-speaking world, and they understood the analogy that's being used here. The analogy is one of a race. It's one of physical endurance. It's one of actually someone literally running a race and actually doing and competing. And the best way to consider this is that whoever wrote this, they understood what the Greek world would understood as like the Olympics. So in your mind, when we read Hebrews 12, think of the Olympics. Think of putting yourself inside of a great cloud of witness, inside of a stadium where all these people are watching you. Now it's your time to run the race. So when we get to chapter 12, it's saying in view of all of Hebrews 11, it's your turn. All of these people have run the race. It's your turn. You have towed the line. It's your race day. Now, we talk about races. We talk about physical feats. But think about that one thing in your life that, you know, if I do this one thing, if I take that class, if I do that, if I put myself in this arena, it's going to challenge me, but it will make me better, right? That, you know, we all have to take things on, that we embrace adversity, because it will inevitably, if we let it run its course and we're diligent, it will make us better, right? So just, we all take hard things on in life, and we do the hard things to get better. And that's exactly what he's saying here. So I want to give you five things in Scripture, right? And we're going to see these right through Hebrews 1. We'll see four of them. And in Hebrews 2, we're going to see the last one. So the first one is this. We talk about building your endurance. If you want to get better at life, like, I'm not saying life's going to get easier, but I'm telling you, you can get better as a person of faith by doing what we've seen other people do. It's number one is this, recruit experience. If you ever endeavor to do something in life and you say, I need to do this, the best thing to do, number one, is to say, I bet someone else has already done this. I bet there's people that I can call and say, hey, you've been here before. You've took this course. You did this. You ran this race. You took on this uh, uh, this obstacle. Like, help me. I need help. Now, men, say this with me. I need help. That's weird. I know it's going to hurt. There's a lot of pain in this, okay? But men, repeat after me. Women, get him in the rib cage. Men, I need help. The first thing you can do is to admit that we need help, that I need someone in my corner. Phil Mickelson has a putting coach. Mike Tyson has someone in his corner who teaches him how to box. Everybody who's at the top of the game, no matter what their arena is, has someone in their corner who's helping in their coaching in their life. We have to welcome people into our arena. And not only to the arena, but into our corner. And so if you're going to recruit experience, Hebrews says it this way in verse 1 of chapter 12. Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, since we're not the first people to have adversity. I know that all of us feel like a little strange little unicorn of sin, and no one's ever dealt with what you've ever dealt with in life. But here's the truth. You're not the first one that life has happened to. All right? Sometimes we just got to remind ourselves, I'm not the first. People have come before me, and I might can learn something from them. So Scripture's saying, in view of all of these people, there's so much to learn from. Hebrews chapter 11 is all, look at all these people you can learn from. Now, not only do we need people to recruit them as a Christian, here's what that looks like. Look all around. We're here in corporate worship. We're together. If you're online, you got people that are right there walking beside you right now, ready to talk. We're not in this alone, right? If you want to go fast, go by yourself. If you want to go far, take people with you, right? Like, you want to go fast, run it out. You want to go far, take people with you. You are built for a relationship. You got to recruit people in your corner. And you got to have people that's speaking truth, telling you the things you don't want to hear and who's holding you accountable. And that means like the literal people in our lives, but it's also mean the way we read Scripture. Do you know that when we read Scripture, it is an opportunity to bring a coach into our life? When I read the story of Joshua, I'm inviting Joshua into my corner. I'm going to learn from Joshua. When I read about Noah, when I read about all these people in Scripture, it is a way to invite a coach into your life. We don't read Scripture just for Scripture's sake. These are voices that we're welcoming into and saying, I need people in my corner who have faced adversity and I can learn from them. So Scripture is full of all these people who can help be a coach in our life. If we're going to endure the things of life, we have to, number one, admit, I need help. I need help, and I can't do this by myself. I need the presence and the accountability of other people, because from this point on, there's so many things I'm going to need help with. And the second one on our list is exactly that. We need people to help us make weight. Now, I use that term, make weight. That's basically, I got to get down to my fight weight, right? Like, I'm going to do this, I got to get down to, or there are some things in my life. So if it's not a body weight, it's like, if I'm going to do this, there's things I need to get rid of. There's certain weight in my life, I need to cut weight. I've got to cut the fat. I've got to get lean and mean. There's things in my life that's keeping me from being and doing what God's called me to do. Now, obviously, in the sports analogy, this makes sense. Now, when I take guys hiking, whether that's on the Appalachian Trail or some other crazy place, one of the things that I do, that they ask, well, what do we take with us? Like, what goes in my backpack? Like, what should I carry in my backpack? So I made a video because it was the number one question. What do I take in my backpack in order to go 3 or 4 days and just be like, it's going to be all right? So I have a video. It's called The Bag Dump. And I literally dump out my bag. And then I talk about, these are the essential things you will need. And then these things are creature comforts. If you want to carry the weight of the creature comfort, good on you, that's your weight, not mine. But to help people delineate the necessary from the things that are basically creature comforts are things that we carry in our bag because we feel like we need it because we're insecure without it. All right? Now, there's a lot of weight in our lives that we carry based upon our own insecurities. Like, because we're saying, God, you're not enough and you won't supply, so I'll be self-sufficient. Anyone ever got any area of your life where have you ever told God, like, I got this? Like, no, I got, you handle that, God, but I'll handle this. We have all these areas in our life. Insecurity causes us to carry more weight than we're designed to carry. Therefore, we get slowed down on life's journey because you're carrying more weight than we actually should carry. So Scripture says it this way, because I want to look at this word. Let us strip off every weight that slows us down. Now, I'm talking about the external weight, but that's not what Scripture is talking about here. What Scripture is talking about, this word weight, is actually a word in the Greek called onkos. It is where we get the word oncology. And if you know someone who's an oncologist, you know that they study into the science of the mass inside. An oncologist is someone who understands cancer. It is a weight. It is a burden. It is something inside of us that's not designed to be there. So when he said, let us throw off the weight, they're not talking about outside. They're saying the things in us that only God knows, but we got to get rid of that weight. There is weight that we're handling. There's a burden. Another way to translate the word weight is burden. There are burdens in our life that we have to get rid of. We have to throw it off in order to run the race we're called to run. There was also the Greek world would have heard something here, and they would, he must be talking about Orsippus. Well, who in the world is Orsippus? In the year 720, in the 15th Greek Olympiad, there was a guy by the name Orsippus who was so dedicated to winning the race that he decided to run naked. And it actually set the course, it actually set the kind of the protocol that from the year 720 on, the Olympics were competed in the nude. Because there was going to be nothing's going to keep me from running. So they would have understood, you mean the Greek world, they're willing literally to throw everything off in order to run the race. And so what's written in Scripture here is cultural, it is internal, there's so much being said. And I only bring up Orsippus to bring up a later point when we get to number 5. So just tie a string around your finger. Number 3, here we go. The third one is this, eliminate distractions. We see this right here. We haven't even got halfway through verse 1, all right? Recruiting help, recruiting experience, casting off the weight, the cancers in our life, the burdens, the weight, the things that should not be there. The third one is this, eliminate distractions. Because if you're going to run the race with endurance, you got to get rid of the weight. But not only weight, you also have to clear the path of the sin that so easily trips us up. Listen to this. He says it this way in verse 1. Especially the sin that so easily trips us up. There's things that keep us from running the race, and it's the pitfalls. It's the things that's going to trip you up. Like, you know they're coming, right? We know the sin patterns, and we know that we're coming, but unless we have the Holy Spirit to help us clear that path, we're going to be susceptible to the pitfalls of sin. And we're going to get tripped up by sin in our life. If we're going to have endurance, we have to have the ability to not only say, there's burdens I need to get rid of, but there's habits I need to keep away. Like, for example, somebody can make weight, and you work out really, really hard, but then you get home and you open that refrigerator and you just crushed the refrigerator because you deserved it, because we didn't purge ourselves of the temptations. I see people make weight all the time, but then they gain it right back because they haven't eliminated the things that got them there. It's one thing to bring your stuff to Jesus, another thing to pick them back up. But we do this all the time, don't we? We lay it at the foot of the cross, and then next week we pick it right back up. And we go, I got this. And we fall into these sin habits. Things that trip us up. There are things on the raceway. There are things on the course that trip us up. The sin that so easily trips us up. It's so easy. We fall right into it. The fourth thing is this. And this is a really big one because this is hard. It's hard because we can't keep our eyes on our own paper when it comes to life. We're just really good at comparing ourselves, right? Social media helps us compare ourselves daily, right? But get this. We have to run patiently. The reason I say run patiently, let's look at this part of the verse. We're still in verse 1. Let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. Now, let me explain what you're not seeing in the English. The word let us run. In the Greek, that word is treko. And the word treko is where we get our word trek. And if you've ever trekked over the hills and through the woods, you're not running. You're over, under, plow. It is an obstacle course. So what is being said in the original language here, this is not a sprint. Life is not a 40-yard dash. It is a trek. It is over the hills, through the woods. There will be things in your path. There will be obstacles to overcome. It will be long. It will be arduous. So let us run the race. Let us understand this is not a sprint. Life is a process. Let us trek with endurance the race God has set before us. But the reason that we don't run this trek really well is because we love to compete, right? Has anyone ever, even on the interstate, like, there's no way that car is going to beat me to the next exit, right? Like, I see these people running all the time. Has anyone ever been running a race, but there was that girl who's running in front of you, who's running a little bit faster, you're like, ain't no way she's going to beat me. Or that one person who's just running a little bit faster, and so out of competition, and competition can be good, but it makes us run someone else's race if we're not careful. And so I will tell you the best way to disqualify yourself and to nullify your training. You can have a coach. You can actually make weight. You can eliminate distractions. But in the race, if you don't run your own race, you will blow yourself up. You'll give out. And so as a Christian, he said, we have to run the race with patience. That's why I said, let's exchange the word endurance with patience. You got to run patiently. You got to run patiently because you got to know this is not a sprint. This is life. This is a trek. And you got to run at a pace that you can sustain. And you can't overcome that. Here's the thing. Like when I help people run faster, and that's something I love to do is help guys get faster in the running. I will tell you this. I don't pay attention to pace. It is a lag measurement. A pace is simply this. Someone runs a mile in so many minutes and seconds. That is a good metric to know, but it is a lag measurement, meaning you can only measure it once you finish that mile. You may know what you think that mile, but until you finish that mile, so here's the thing. It is a lag measurement. It's better to understand lead measurements, which is a heart rate. So for me, if I'm training someone to get better, you need to know your heart rate. You need to know where your heart is, because your heart operates in an aerobic zone. But if you try to run someone else's race, you're going to get above your aerobic zone and get in what we call anaerobic zone, where you have no oxygen and you're going to blow up. The problem with that as a runner is if we try to run someone else's race and we don't know the speed of our heart, we will blow up. Now, I'd have to start preaching now and tell you that if you don't pay attention to the pace of your heart and what God's doing in your heart and the pace of your heart and where your heart is at all times, you can run someone else's race, but you will burn out and fade away. Are you with me on that? Like, what I'm trying to tell you is that your heart is something you have to know what the lockstep is. And so the pacer is not the person in front of you. It's what's God doing in my heart. It's so easy to look at Instagram and Facebook and say, look what God's doing in their life. I don't care. What's God doing in your heart? That's my question. I don't care what God's doing in the world. Like, what's God doing in your heart right now? Where is your heart? Because no amount of success in the world can make up failure at home. Where's your heart right now? You got to run with patience. You got to walk with the Spirit. You have to make sure you don't get out in front of the Spirit. Now, the last thing is this. Focusing on Jesus. And we got to keep our eyes on Jesus because he's the finish line. He's the author and the perfecter. He is the destination. And Jesus is, we have to keep our eyes on him because he's the destination. He's the goal line. You always have to know the direction and the distance of the goal line. Whatever the finish line is, if you don't know the direction, you'll miss it. Good speed will never overcome bad direction. You should never travel faster than you can navigate. Like all the speed in the world, if you're going in the wrong direction, won't get you to the finish line. So when knowing where the destination is, but we also know the distance between us and the goal line, knowing the distance between you and Jesus at all times. And you got to know, how do I close that gap and how do I get there? Focusing on Jesus. Scripture says it this way. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith because of the joy awaiting him. Like Jesus is the one. We look at him and we model him and he had a joy. Now here's where people go like, you mean like, so where is there joy in pain? Well, you can have joy in pain, but you won't have happiness in pain. Because what we seek is happiness, but joy and happiness are not the same thing. The call to the Christian life is not to one of happiness, but of joy. Happiness is an emotional response to something you have as a human. Joy is a conscious decision that we can choose to have, even in the face of suffering. Joy is a choice. And we know this because Jesus took joy on the way to the cross. Jesus, I promise you, wasn't happy about being beaten within inches of his death, about being paraded through the streets naked. I bet you it didn't bring him happiness, but there was a joy in his heart because when you have joy and you take joy in the hardship, it will get you through. For example, let's say a guy comes to work out with us on any given day, and the guy says, "Hey, I go, Bob, why are you here?" And Bob says, "Well, it's beach body season, right? I got to get ready for beach body, right? I got to look good. I'm at the family reunion down at the beach." I'm like, "Well, it's going to be nice seeing you for the next 2 weeks. Because after that, you'll be gone. You won't last." But if a guy comes to me and says, "The reason I'm here is because the doctor told me if I don't get a hold of my health and my heart, I won't live to see my kids graduate." Welcome to the club. That is a fully developed why. That's a joy, because the joy of the cross, how does Jesus endure the cross? Because he knew that it wasn't about him and what he looked like. He had us on his mind. When people endure hardship, when we keep other people in mind, it is a joy. As a parent, kids don't make me happy all the time, right? Y'all know this as a parent, right? Kids don't always bring happiness. That's a lie. Like, thank you for clapping. Like, kids are great. Kids are great. And they bring us great joy. But joy and happiness are not the same thing as a parent. But we endure it with great joy, because it ain't about me. It's about what God wants to do through me on behalf of my children. And I'll endure it. Whatever's going to happen, whatever got to go through, I'll endure it and count it all as joy. Goes on to say, he endured the cross, disregarding the shame. And now, talking about the greatest podium finish ever, he's seated at the right hand of the Father. Right now, I'm going to hand this sermon off in Aner, because Bensfield is actually going to walk through the book of James, and we'll do the same here. But I want to hand this off to Aner, and we're going to continue to ask the question, how do we walk this out, especially as Scripture instructs us? Now, I want to hold this Scripture here, if we could. This, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. And I want to just as extra credit today, all right? Disregarding its shame. Why is that little piece of a verse in there? It is something the writer of Hebrews is doing so astutely. You remember how I said that they would have thought about the guy who threw off anything? His name was Orsippus, and he would have thrown off. He ran naked, and after that, actually one of the emperors said, we're all going to compete naked from here on out. That was the thing about, you can Google it, not images, but just Google the context, right? So you can look this up. It's true. But what the writer is doing here is saying that Jesus endured the nakedness of the cross, because to be crucified, in a lot of ways, you were naked. Now, there's a question, was he truly naked, or did he have a loincloth on? There's a lot of questions about that. But what we understand is this. What the Greek world held, kind of put on the podium, here's the great physique, here's the winner, this is the target of all humanity right here. Look at him on the podium. But for the Jewish person to be heralded up in nakedness was a shame. Nakedness was a shame to the Jewish person. And so what the writer of Hebrews is doing is trying to help us to see what the world positions as the best that humanity has to offer. God said, let me show you what the best the cross has to offer. You think about the podium finish between those heralded on a podium with a gold chain on versus Jesus being heralded on the cross. And what the writer of Hebrews here is trying to help us to hold these two things, to say, if you want to endure, don't look at what the world does and what the world celebrates as victory, but see what God heralds as victory. Even the shame of the cross is victory. Now, the book of James says it this way. It's not if, brothers and sisters. It is, brothers and sisters, when you face trials, right? It's when trials come, life is going to hurt. And it's not if, and I say it this way, if ifs and buts were candies and nuts, we'd all have a Merry Christmas. But that ain't life. Life is going to hurt. Life's going to kick you in the teeth. Some of you know that already. It's not a newsflash. Life hurts. But here's the cool thing. We can face these trials, and we can consider it nothing but joy. Consider it. It's like you have to get it in your mind that joy is a valid response when happiness is no longer there. Like, you can choose joy. You can consider this may be an opportunity to grow. And there's pain in the purpose if I let it speak. So he says, because you know this, the testing of your faith produces endurance. Like, when our faith gets tested, our patience gets stronger. Our endurance gets stronger. We get better. Remember, it doesn't say life gets easier. It says you get better. You get better at handling whatever life throws your way. You build a resilience, an emotional and spiritual and a physical resilience to know if people have come before me and they have endured it and Jesus has set the example, then I can too. Through the help of the Holy Spirit, it produces an endurance. So let that patience, let that endurance have a full effect. A lot of times people shrink back from the pain, but lean into it. There's purpose in it sometimes. And when that happens, you can have the full effect, being mature, complete, lacking nothing. Now, what if, like, what would look different in your life? What if I told you today that you don't have to go through life alone? Look at these five principles up here. Like, you don't have to go through life alone. What if I told you today that you can recruit experience? Like, what if I told you, like, look around this room, you're not alone. We're in this together. What if I told you that Scripture is full of coaches and people and wisdom that you can bring into your life every day to get better and to be coached by people in Scripture? What if I told you that the God of the universe says, I want to walk with you? and you can welcome God into your corner. What if I told you that you don't have to leave here today with the same weight you walked in here with? What if I told you there's things on the outside, things in your heart that's weighing you down, that's cancerous, that God can remove and take from you today? You don't have to run with the weight of the burden and all the things by yourself. What if you could eliminate some things today? What would that be? What if I told you? What if it's possible that God can help you eliminate sin in your life? What if I told you God could help clear the path and keep you from falling into the same lies with Satan? What if I told you that was true? And what if I told you that he wants to do that? Would you receive it? What if I told you that you can run in step with God and you don't have to compete with anyone else? Like, what if you found your complete worth today in who God sees you as versus what the world sees you as? The Greeks heralded, like, look at what the perfect model and the specimen of humanity is. And God says, no, you show me one who bows before me at the cross, I'll show you victory. What if I told you don't have to compete with no one else, but you can run in step with God, and he'll give you patience. He'll walk with you. And what if I told you that if you keep your eyes on Jesus, that you always have your eyes on a goal worth attaining? And what if I told you that the direction is Jesus? And what if I told you today we could close the gap between you and the finish line? Jesus on the cross said, tetelestai, it is finished. What if I told you today that you don't have to run this race, you can participate in the victory that's already been won? That this life doesn't depend on your victory, but in the shared victory of the cross of Jesus Christ. And you let his victory speak over you. Friends, I invite us to stand. We're gonna respond to this today. And I know God wants to do things in our hearts, and God's making a way for us right now. I know that there are people here who need to invite God into their presence, into their corner, and to know that the God of the universe is on your side. I know there's people here today that need to get some weight off your chest and weight off your heart, and you want to run free, and you want to run the race God set before you, but you're weighed by the weight of sin. But what if I told you this sin has an answer and his name is Jesus? What if I told you peace is a person and his name is Jesus? What if I told you the Holy Spirit wants to speak into your heart today so that you have life, abundance? And what if I told you today that Jesus is near? God, I ask you to move in our hearts and our minds the only way that you can. Lord God, we want to have a spiritual and a physical resilience that's based upon in Jesus, is because he is the model. He is the one who is the author and the pioneer and the perfecter of the race run before us. He endured it. He took the cross on. He embraced the cross. He understood the meaning of having joy. And on the cross, you saw us. You saw me, a sinner, Lord God, and it brought you joy to die for me and for every person under the sound of my voice. Lord God, it brings you joy to know that we can be redeemed today, and you are the finish line, Lord God. That our only aim, our only hope is found in Jesus Christ, our Lord. So God, move in our way, in our hearts in a way that you can. Be our way maker today. And everyone agreed and said,
every heart. I worship you.
darkness, my God, that is who you are. Sing it out today, is way make
miracle work, promise keep light in the darkness,
my God, that is who you are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working.
Caught up in your presence, yeah, I just wanna sit here at your feet. Caught up in this holy moment, never wanna leave. I'm not here for blessing, Jesus, you don't owe me anything, more than anything sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where it started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. Caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. Caught up in this hole. Nothing else.